your eyes. Wow.
If you've seen one tarantula wrangling pyromaniac hermaphrodite dwarf, you've seen them all, right? Wrong. That's why you need to watch Talk Soup. We're coming up next, right here on E!
I wanted to make sure that there wouldn't be any nipples.
Make out party tonight.
One other thing, my ass itches.
You're watching Talk Soup, the show that's so mirthful it's not even funny. I'm John Henson. I think you can hear the head cold is coming along nicely now. Yes. Hear the nasalness. Yes. Yes, Alex, a little bit of nastiness. Yes. In fact, I think it's moving into my my chest now. I'm starting to wheeze a little bit. Yeah, listen. It's not good.
You're huge.
I gotta talk to a doctor. Coming up on today's show, we'll be meeting a guy with a petrified forest in his pants. We'll be curling till we're hurling, and we'll learn about Harold Robbins' sex after death fantasy. But first, these words of advice.
Stay fabulous, beautiful people, and have faith. Don't let the man beat you down.
Yeah, you know, the day a Space Ghost highlight makes sense to me will be the day they carry me out in a net. The following Jerry highlight has certain parallels to President Clinton's sex life. After all, David stands accused of cheating on his mate Tia not once, not twice, but many, many times with many, many different women. Up next, Tia comes face to face with the new squeeze in David's life, Terry.
Uh-oh.
Right now, apparently, you got another girlfriend.
I got somewhere to go now.
Well, go ahead.
Well, here she is, Terry.
Right
that,
now,
believe that.
Just a matter of time before Jerry goes pay-per-view, don't you think?
Pay-per-view.
It's better than the Ultimate Fighting Championship. Meanwhile, here's Tia's sister, Renette.
The nastiest dog.
Shut up!
Let him say something.
Just said she's throwing that phantasm ball. The one with the three little spikes that follows you around. Oh, it's the old phantasm ball and the shoe trick. Friday on Jerry. Guess what? I've been keeping a secret. In fact, it's so hush-hush, I don't even know what I'm talking about. I can't. I'm clueless. If the following highlight is any indication, Jay Leno's writers must read a heck of a lot of newspapers. How else could they possibly call it the Phantasm Ball? That thing scared the pee out of me. Okay. How else could they possibly call so many wacky wedding announcements? Here's Jay discussing the strange couplings they've discovered.
How about the Scratcher Lincoln wedding? It's the Crow Scaring wedding. Crummy sweat wedding? I like this couple here. They look happy. They're the Daffy Duckman wedding. Daffy Duckman? I like these two here. Look, it's the Yellow Belly wedding. Yeah. There's the Lover Honeyman wedding. The May Breed Love. It's the Jabbin' Pain wedding.
It's the Laymore wedding. And this one here, oh man, I can't believe this one. It's the Reamer and Out wedding.
Oh, well, sounds like they've got quite a honeymoon in store. Friday on The Tonight Show, find out what's new with Kelsey Grammer. He'll be talking about his new Babelicious wife. Grace Robbins was married to novelist Harold Robbins for over 28 years. As her husband reached his late 60s, his health began to fail, so he required the services of a live-in nurse. Remarkably, despite the illness, Robbins struck up a liaison with the frisky young caretaker. Here's Grace telling Sally about the affair.
You said the woman started to change and in a way started to act like you.
Oh yeah, this was something that I noticed was happening.
She was wearing your type of clothes,
right,
changing
exactly.
her hair to look like you.
Exactly.
Right?
And then one day she asked if she could have some breast implants. and so she said, I need your permission because I may be away for a week or two, but if you say no, I won't do it. And I said, but, you know, I wouldn't say no. If this is something you really want, then do it. I found out Harold paid for the implants. Well, that's when I decided it was time for me to get away from all that.
Harold Robbins eventually died and was cremated, but Grace didn't get to keep any of the ashes, which is kind of a shame. Here's why.
Harold used to say, when I die, I want you to take a pinch of my ashes and put them in a locket and wear that locket all the time. And when you're having some special pleasures, just put it on your shoulder and let me watch.
Friday on Sally, you meet a mom who found herself on trial for slapping her teenage daughter. Innocent victim or dangerous abuser? Just tune in and decide for yourself. Still to come on TalkTube, meet the human erector set. Enter the mind of a serial killer. And after the break, an alternative rocker gets philosophical.
I've got an atomic drink mixer. An ultra-deluxe chick magnet.
One of them must dim the lights in your...
He was an...
I think TalkTube needs a new theme song. You should use old school beatbox.
Oh, I don't know if I like the way that one ended. That,
it was good right up until the end.
Right up until the flatulence, it was fine. Space Ghost's evil twin Chad recently orchestrated a coup d'etat and took over his talk show. But besides the goatee and the sinister persona, is Chad really that different from his famous bro? That's what the millionaire intends to find out. He's the lead singer of a pop group known as Combustible Edison. Here he is giving Chad the third degree.
So do the buttons on your gauntlet do something entirely different than his? I've always wondered about that.
Oh, you know it, Dad.
What do yours do?
Well, let me clue you. I've got an atomic drink mixer. An ultra-deluxe chick magnet.
One of them must dim the lights in your chamber.
Oh, yeah. Make out party tonight.
That's a good one.
You know it, baby. So, any last words of advice for our lonely little viewers?
Stay fabulous, beautiful people, and have faith. Don't let the man beat you down.
All right. Listen, my main queen Elvira's throwing a blast tonight. Want to swing by?
Beautiful.
Thanks for dropping by, millionaire. See you tonight.
Thank you, Chad.
Swanky fool. Tonight your millions shall be mine.
You know, believe it or not, one of those guys wasn't a cartoon. I have it on good authority, Tom. Friday on Space Ghost, get to know yet another celebrity guest. He or she will engage in a rambling, disjointed dialogue with whomever happens to be sitting in or hovering above the host chair. Now let's talk about Rebecca Romijn's nipples. Both of them. You see, the sexy cover girl recently appeared on Late Night with Conan O'Brien to discuss one of her racier modeling assignments. Here she is, baring her chest, metaphorically speaking, in front of all of America.
I mean, I really bugged the editors about making sure everything would be airbrushed out. You know, like nipples. Is that okay?
You can say nipples.
I can say nipples.
We've established that you can say nipples on. You could have said nipple in your segment.
Did I say that?
Yeah.
Nipples.
Yeah. Nipples. There you go. All right. You can say nipples. You're allowed.
Well, nipples seem to be the distinguishing factor between nudity and non-nudity. So, like, I wanted to make sure that there wouldn't be any nipples.
So they sent you, like, a contract
or something? No, they didn't, actually. No, I kept calling them. They kept saying, you have our word. There will be no nipples. There will be no nipples. And I was like, you know what? We were at the shoot, and I went, you know what? Your word isn't quite good enough. So I called up Art Cooper. I said, I really would feel more comfortable if it was in writing. So he sent me this fax a half hour later that goes, I pledge to you that no one shall ever see a nipple on GQ that belongs to thee. And if the offending areola should show, I promise you we'll make it go. And then he signed it, and that was like my official legitimate. And I was like sitting there picturing Art Cooper, like looking for a rhyme for areola, you know. Like.
RC Cola.
Ebola. Payola. Ayatollah. Mariola. She's on our staff. Friday on Conan, find out what's new with Dan Cortez. He's appearing in the Kirstie Alley sitcom Veronica's Closet. For 20 years, Robert Ressler investigated... Isn't it Robert Kressler?
What is it, David?
Is it Robert Ressler?
I am checking.
Okay, stand by while David checks, won't you? Thank you very much. Robert Ressler investigated serial killers for the FBI. Think of him as a male version of Jodie Foster's character in The Silence of the Lambs. In this Montel highlight, Ressler discusses some of the gruesome crimes he investigated during his tenure with the Bureau.
I'm not sure I understand the psychodynamics of the serial killers in terms of dismemberment. First off, do they dismember most of their victims before they die? Or if afterwards, do they do it for the purposes of storage of the body parts? Or is there some kind of a ritualistic meaning to them?
Hold on a second. Before you answer this question, if you have young children in the house right now watching, please send them out of the room because the answer, I think, is relatively graphic. There's three different ways that they do this, isn't it?
Dismemberment is only an element of the way some of them will do their crimes, and the fact is that they don't all dismember. Those that do, again, there's reasons. Some is for just because of personal curiosity and just becoming very perverse, as did Dahmer. Dahmer would really take his bodies down right down to the core and would eliminate, for example, he flushed most of his victims down the commode. But some will, like Ed Kemper, would decapitate and get rid of, for example, he'd cut the hands off and dispose of them because a handless and headless body it cannot be identified very easily. So he had a reason for that. But there's no one reason.
Robert Ressler has written a book entitled I Have Lived in the Monster. It includes excerpts from his conversations with John Wayne Gacy, Jeffrey Dahmer, and Richard Ramirez. Friday on Montel, psychic Sylvia Brown will be dropping by once again. What will she discuss? Well, I'll have to check my crystal ball and get back to you. Coming up, a young man who lives in a state of constant arousal. But first, it's comedy.com with Mr. Showstar Bob Odenkirk.
Monday.
You know, when I asked for new theme songs, that wasn't what I had in mind. In this later highlight, half-baked star Harlan Williams interviews Bob Odenkirk for Mr. Show. Excuse me. Bob and his partner David Cross have plenty of hardcore fans, and many of them like surfing the net and such. Here's a look at some of the emails they've received in recent weeks.
There's a lot of lonely people out there. That's what
do you mean by that, Bob?
Well, you know, Let me just read some of these.
Okay, read some of your fan emails.
There's something about email, too, that makes people think they can be a lot more casual with you than they would be if they wrote you a letter.
Yeah.
They don't try as hard, is what I'm trying to say. And I'll get to it now. Does anybody know email at all? Okay. Hey, here's one. Okay, please. Hey, guys, your show is great.
Yeah.
I'm hungry. I think I'll get some yogurt now. I have some in the fridge. Anyway, keep up the good work. And one other thing, my ass itches.
Oh, man.
That's from Todd in Milwaukee.
Wow, Todd, yeah.
Here's one from a guy named Charlie. Yeah. Dear Bob and David, hooray for Mr. Show. I can't stop laughing. I have a cat named Stan. There's something in my teeth. What is psoriasis? Anyway, keep up the good work. Also, my ass itches.
Oh.
Somehow people seem to think I want to know that.
Real itchy bums.
Yeah, I
don't know. Very anal aggressive audience they have there.
Thursday on Later, more fun with guest host Harlan Williams. He'll interview anyone who decides to drop by, including a few audience members and a big gaffer named Harold.
Let's just think about that.
In just over a week, in Nagano, the sport of curling will become a full-fledged Olympic event.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah, I know how you like curling. This is such a big breakthrough for curlers everywhere. Woo-hoo! By the way, here are some of the tools of the trade. First, you got your curling broom. Then you got your curling rock. And finally, your curling target, or house. Put them all together, and you got the following This Morning highlight. Yep.
You just put a turn on the rock and just going to put an intern or out turn.
No interns for me. Nothing to do with interns.
Okay, then we'll throw an out there today.
Yeah. All right. I don't want anything
okay,
to do
so
with
what you're going to do is you're going to be aiming at the target down there.
Okay.
You push the rock forward.
Yeah.
Lift your trunk.
Trunk?
Yeah, like lift up.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Swing the rock back.
Okay.
And Stacy and Eric will sweep for you.
Yeah.
We'll holler
and I just
in.
Have to go towards the center.
Just going towards the center. Nice okay. and easy. Put her. Okay, sweep, guys. Hurry. Oh, you got to get it there. See, now you can see it's curling.
Yeah, and that
okay,
has to
by
do with
sweeping
the sweeping.
It, there, yeah, by sweeping it, and because you put the turn on it,
uh-huh.
it's going to curl.
The out.
You put an out turn on it.
Out turn on it, yeah.
So,
so there it goes. Now I'm actually making it close to the, hey,
you're
not
actually
bad,
doing
huh?
that pretty darn good.
All right, now my time to sweep if I can get this shoe back on.
Okay, you're going to sweep.
And very quickly.
Okay, so Lori and Debbie's going to throw, and Lori's going to
all right, let's sweep very quickly.
Okay. Here we go.
Now the sweeping. I don't even do this at home. My mom's saying, with a broom, never seen him do that. Okay.
Okay, the more pressure, and I'll put you. Okay, hurry. Okay, get in front of the rock. You gotta get in front of the rock.
Come on, sweep faster. I'm here just as an observer.
All right.
Okay.
All the way.
That gives you an idea, hopefully. They'll be in Nagano, we'll be in Nagano, we'll be doing some sweeping, and hopefully we'll get a medal, right?
That's right.
I love curling as much as the next guy. Unfortunately, the next guy really isn't that into it. My dad loves it, though.
Really?
Yeah, he's totally into it. That's how he made all his money, gambling on curling.
Wow.
Yeah. It's good living to be made. Friday on This Morning, get to know a big shot celebrity guest. Chances are it won't be Robert Mitchum, but if it were, wouldn't that be amazing?
Yeah.
When we return, a young man whose body doesn't know the meaning of the phrase, at ease.
Well, the thing is, it's like, have sex and it's like, you're like waiting for it to go down so you can go to the grocery store and stuff like that, you know?
A murdered one.
That excited.
You're watching Talk Soup. I'm the congested John Henson.
Time now to check in with a Loveline caller who can't seem to keep his natural enthusiasm to himself. His name is John, of course, and he's such a stud he can't subdue his overachieving member. Here's Mr. Perpendicular chatting with Drew, Adam, and funny man Bobcat Goldthwait.
When I achieve erection, it'll stay hard for like 6.5
Liar,
seven hours.
Liar, we can see it.
Yeah.
How long?
Like 6.5 seven hours at a time. I'll have like multiple
And that's
orgasms.
A bad thing?
Well, the thing is, it's like... have sex and it's like you like waiting for it to go down so you can go to the grocery store and stuff like that, you know, go to work. I mean, it's
you might want to pay my ass.
Clean up aisle six. Even after you orgasm, it never goes away.
Yeah, correct.
Are you, it never does?
Well, like 3 or 4 hours later, you know, it'll like finally drop.
Are you on any medication?
No.
Nothing? No.
Nothing.
Just what?
A headache.
What is
Tylenol,
that?
Tylenol, you know, over-the-counter prescriptions, but that's it. Nothing else.
You keep saying You know, just because we can't see you, we can still hear you.
That glass structure John was lurking behind is known as the hidden igloo. Other identity-concealing set pieces featured on Loveline include the wax paper castle and the cocoon of dirty gauze.
Ooh, dirty gauze.
Yeah, I know how you love dirty gauze, Tom. Friday on Loveline. Don't be shy. Everybody's doing it. Find out what's what, who's who, and why's why in the wonderful world of sex. Tomorrow on Talk Soup, it's ultimatum time on the Jerry Springer Show.
I'ma tell you like this, if he does pick her, he better get his ass back to her house before I do, or going to the Salvation Army.
Yeah.
Well, it appears we've run out of highlights. Don't blame me. Bye.